not cold. This camel is tough on the spine.
Hit me with a band-aid, Dad.
We may run into villains, but we're not afraid to roam. Because we read the story and we end up safe at home.
Yeah,
certainly do get around. Like Webster's Dictionary, we're Morocco-bound.
Of all the gin joints in all the towns in all the world, she walks into mine.
The Queen has been welcomed to Morocco by King Hassan and a crowd estimated at...
Last night in Tangier, a lavish party was thrown in Morocco.
The policeman had to say, where do you do it? And the boy had to say, on crowded dance floors during the rumba.
We certainly do get around. We're Morocco.
I heard you went to Morocco to do a thing there. Explain, what happened?
Well, we did a track with this North African piece, and we had this tribe of musicians called Jajuka that, but many, many years ago, Brian Jones recorded, mm-hmm. and we put out this record on Rolling Stone's label. And they wrote to us and said, you know, we'd like to do some more things. The guy died, who was the head of the tribe, and his son had taken over, and he was younger, and he lived a bit in New York, and he wanted to get involved. So we said, that's a great idea for this piece, you know, so we went to Morocco and recorded them.
You recorded the entire song in Morocco?
No, no, we recorded the song, and then we recorded them playing along with it. They played the strange pipes, and they have a mystical ceremony every year for these, which relives the ceremony of the pipes of Pan, which is a very old tradition. And we knew that these pipes would work very, very well over this track, so we did that.
I'm Bashir Attar, and I'm son of the master musician of Jajuka. I'm Tik, my father's place, and this is the home of my father, music. I'm learning this music when I am about 4 years old, and you're welcome.
This is the other El Minza car, sweetie. Yeah.
Okay. Come here.
Yeah. Are we driving? Am I driving?
No. Can you pack the boot?
Yes. All right.
And I'll see you down in the El Minz in about an hour.
Okay, put it in the other car.
Put it in the other car.
Okay.
Throughout this century, the liberal and exotic atmosphere of Tangier has been a lure for Westerners seeking inspiration, adventure, and in some cases, refuge. Jack Kerouac made the journey in 1957, and a few years later, William Burroughs made several of these extraordinary home movies. Burroughs also wrote his most famous novel, The Naked Lunch, largely in Tangier. Gregory Corso and Allen Ginsberg joined the 50s Beat Party, but the uncrowned king of the expatriate artists was Paul Bowles, the American novelist and composer who had been living in Tangier since the 30s. Bowles was one of the first Westerners to go up into the hills and hear the extraordinary music of Jajouka. Before starting the recording session, Mick Jagger paid a visit.
Is it a long time since you've heard these Jajouka people? It's a long time.
Except on tapes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I haven't been down there since I was in the 50s. I went down with Brian Geisen.
Geisen, yeah.
And, well, oh, Hamry.
Yeah.
You know Hamry?
I met him once, I think.
I think he's persona non grata in Jajouka now.
Is he? What did he do? Yeah.
Oh, he went to London and picked up all the royalties for the album. It was supposed to be divided democratically in the village.
Because did you go when Brian Jones went there? When Brian Jones went there?
He wasn't there when I was there, no. No, I was there before that.
Yeah, and that's the 50s, and he went there in, like, 67 or something.
Quite much later, yes.
Something like that, and then maybe it was earlier than that, but we put out the album, but he changed the sounds a lot of it. I mean, he did all kinds of strange things with it, processed it.
It comes in and out.
That's it, it's all phases. But that record's quite well-known now in sort of a cult way.
Oh, yeah. I think it was quite quickly after it was issued.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Jajouka is about 50 miles south of Tangier, in the foothills of the Rift Mountains. The musicians have traditionally been supported by the local people, and they have effectively acted as court musicians, playing at weddings and celebrations. There are festivals where they play for 10 hours at a time. Once a year, they reenact the rites of Pan in the festival of Boujolou, which embodies a mixture of fertility rites. The dancer dressed in animal skins represents Pan, who's held to have given the villagers the gift of music in return for local woman. On finding out he had been tricked into accepting the village idiot, he cures her madness. Ever since, the village and the music of Jajouka have been renowned as a cure for mental illness. Thank you.
This scent is special for crazy people. Many people come here and we guard them like this, you know, and when they stay here about 1 month, or somebody is more sick, he can stay here about 2 months or 3 months. Few people they stay here, and this is the truth. When they stay here, they go and finish with the problems they have, or for crazy people. The people come from Europe, from England, directly to this scent. And the people come from America to here, to visit, because they listen about Saint Sidi Ahmed Sheikh, what he mean. Because he's big Sufi who come to present the Islam in first here in this village. And he give the name for this village, Zahwan Ja'aka. Something coming good for you. The name of Jeju come in. Something good come to you.
The Jezuka, they did have this sort of odd historical connection, which was kind of appealing somehow.
Jezuka.
Very tenuous, admittedly, but it did have a sort of... And there was this coincidental thing where... when I was writing this song that we're going to do this drumming on and playing pipes and so on tomorrow, I said, oh, this would be great if we could have someone like Jezuka on it. And like the week after, I got a letter from them saying, could we come and play on a show we did? So it was very coincidental, that part of it. But we sent them the tape, right? We sent the tape to Bashir. And, but it was in a very early state. There was no singing on it. There was no, nothing really except just the drum. So we've got to rehearse it tomorrow morning. So I don't know how quickly they can learn or whatever. Might take a while, what do you think?
Well, they've been practicing, haven't they?
I think so.
That's what I'm told. I believe it.
We live in hope. But you're quite pessimistic about most things. You're quite pessimistic about most things.
About most things, yes. Yeah.
First time I've been back in 20 odd years, and it's...
Is it still pretty much the same place?
It is pretty much the same. It's a little bigger on the outside. The town's, you know, there's a few more farmers, but right here in the centre of the town, it's exactly the same, really. Maybe a few more donkeys back in those days. And just to be able to hang around somewhere and listen to other people's music, and it was so fascinating after just listening to your own for 5 years.
I mean, and now it's all very fashionable, this sort of world music.
Yeah, well, I think that's got to do a lot with communications, right? We get, people start to hear more and more about what's going on in other places, and there's more contact between people, and so something that would have appeared really sort of exotic and strange maybe 20 years ago slowly starts, people start to accept other the music from other parts of the world. Thank you.
خالتي كنا نتكلم عليها بزاف خلي هذا يزيد This is Ali.
Ali.
Yeah. هذا ميك جاجر معلم كبير. This is Abdullah.
Abdullah.
هذا ميك جاجر.
تمام.
This is Ali.
Ali.
هذا ميك جاجر. This is my brother Mustafa. My
little brother. Your younger brother?
Yeah. This is my little brother.
This is your older brother. Yeah. You're not so bad with him?
No.
You're strong with him?
Yes, he plays with me the music. We play some time together, man. This is Abdul Nabi. Hada Mick Jagger. This is Abdullah.
Abdullah.
This is Muhammad.
Muhammad.
This is old man. He wants to see you. Busu, she busa. He wants to kiss you. And I think he meet you a long time in Tangier.
In Tangier?
In 1001 night with Brian Geisen.
With Brian Geisen, yes. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. This is his name, Ali.
Ali, hello, Ali.
Hada Mick Jagger.
Hi. Hi.
Aji. Hada Muhammad.
Muhammad.
Mick Jagger, معلم كبير. This is Mukhtar.
Hi.
Mick Jagger. This I'd be very happy to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
This is Ali. This is Abslam.
Abslam. Hi.
This is Lahsan.
Lahsan.
Hada Mick Jagger.
Good.
This is all of them
this
here,
is good.
And they are very, very, very happy. We're waiting for you 20 years ago. We're waiting for you, Nick, and all of them. Be very, very happy.
Well, I'm very happy that we could all come.
Thank you very much. Hada Ran, this is Abdullah. This is Kim Rishad. Ran with.
Yeah,
it was so much fun.
Joe,
keep
the rhythm. Yes, and Ramya,
Joe,
keep the rhythm.
Keep the
rhythm, Ramya. You're welcome.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
I could tell
that
I could find my way.
We just been
playing.
Yeah, we play with your rhythm.
Track.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. With the song. Yeah. Right. How's it sound? Good.
The sounds is perfect.
Perfect.
It's fantastic.
Good.
Thank you.
Just an idea that Mick and I looked at and said, well, if ever we could use the Zhuka pipes, this is probably the track to do it on, you know. They pick it up amazingly quickly at first. It's just this cacophony of sound, but then suddenly you start, they're getting their patterns down, you know. It's not a lot of drums, you know. They all have to work out what they're going to play. But, it's the pipes I want to hear next.
Piece,
yeah,
that's really great if we could get that.
Yeah. Right. We're
doing
a
section.
Yeah, yeah.
They did a really good end then.
Mm-hmm.
Which we can put in.
Yes.
For the stops.
What we have to have adequate bits for each section. Yeah. You know, to think that we need. So. Mm. So should we just go for this really fast section now?
Yeah, I think yes. From the speeding up, I mean, I don't know if.
And we'll get that speed out. Certainly when they get into that, when it goes for a long time.
Yeah, when it's for a long time on the speed, we can do that.
And that is really, that's really important.
That's what I think we should go for next.
Yeah, and then give him a break.
Yeah,
and then give him a break and then try a bit more.
Yeah, we can do a little bit separate drumming after this.
And then pipes after them.
Yeah. So after the pub. Let's go for the speeding up.
He's got a red line. It was 1967, and we'd all been, my house had been raided by the boys in blue, and we thought, well, that's a good start to a year off. So we said, well, yeah, let's get out of here.
When Mick Jagger and Keith Richard came out of court, they were surrounded
Some friends of ours, Robert Fraser, Christopher Gibbs, were coming down, and Michael Cooper. We're coming down to Morocco, so we said we'd join them down here. So I felt like driving, so I drove from London through France and Spain with Brian and Anita. And Brian got ill, I remember, and so we carried on without him and left him in a hospital. And eventually, when we got here, he was already better and he was already at the hotel. So and after that, things get kind of hazy because we were so punch drunk from all that time on the road. But we were here for weeks before we then drove on to Marrakesh. And we were just wandering around listening to music.
Whilst they were in Marrakesh, the Rolling Stones met royal photographer Cecil Beaton, who had been visiting Morocco since the 30s. He photographed them and recorded the meeting in his diary.
An evening with the Rolling Stones, Marrakesh, March 1967. On Tuesday evening, I came down to dinner very late. And to my surprise, sitting in the hotel lobby, discovered Mick Jagger and a sleepy-looking band of gypsies. It was a strange group. I don't want to give the impression that I was only interested in Mick, but it happened that we sat next to one another as he drank a vodka Collins and smoked with pointed finger held high. His skin is chicken breast white and of fine quality. He has an inborn elegance. He talks of native music. He'd heard a local tribe playing pipes like those used in Hungary and Scotland. He liked Indian music too. He said he'd like to go to Kashmir and Afghanistan, in fact to get right away from England, which he considered had become a police state with harassment and interference. He maintained that he'd done nothing to deprave the youth of the country.
If one is on one's own in a private house, not doing any harm to anyone, I don't really see why all these people should wander in and say you're doing something wrong. Well, he's not committing a crime against society, perhaps against himself, it may be true to say.
The next day at 11 o'clock, Mick appeared at the swimming pool. I could not believe it was the same person walking towards us. The very strong sun reflected from the white ground made his face look a white, podgy, shapeless mess. Eyes very small, nose very pink and spreading, hair sandy dark. His figure, his hands and his arms were incredibly feminine. Their wardrobe is extensive, but everything is shoddy, poorly made, the seams burst. Keith himself had sewn his trousers, lavender and dull rose, with a band of badly stitched leather dividing the two colours. Brian, at the pool, appears in white pants with a huge black square applied onto the back. It's very smart in spite of the fact that the seams are giving way. But with such marvellously flat, tight, compact figures as they have, with no buttocks or stomachs, almost anything looks well on them.
Was that the trip where Brian heard of the Jajuka musicians?
I think so, eventually, yeah, because we were a long time in Marrakesh. We came back to Tangier, and that's, I think, when Brian got to hear about them. Because he came, when he got back to London, he was saying, I'm going to go back and record these guys, you know. And so that was our first contact. At that time, he was always the first one in the band to bring in other elements of other people's music. You know, he was in the sitar. He's very interesting. Also, he was very adept at You could get, Brian would walk in the studio and no matter what instrument was lying around, even though he'd never played it before, he'd be able to knock something out of it very, very quickly, you know. Hence, we used to use vibraphones and stuff, mainly just because they were lying around in the studio and everybody thought, what a wonderful piece of orchestration. But it was just sheer accident. And Brian's ability to be able to get something out of an instrument, hence he'd pick up some sort of primitive sort of instrument, say here, and be able to play it. You know, so he brought more exotic tones to the band, shall we say? You know,
he left the band, and we don't know what happened since. But do you think if he'd stayed, would the music have taken a different course under him? Would the band even stay together?
I wonder. I mean, it's very difficult to say. Brian, as a guy, was one of those guys who said, I'll never make 30, and actually proved it. You know? I mean, so I really think he was burning out at the end. And then, so the question of if he was a different kind of person, then he wouldn't have been able to do what he did. I think there was a sense of urgency about Brian. I think he had some fatalistic idea that he wasn't going to make it for too long, and so he was trying to cram everything in at once, you know.
After travelling to Jujuka in 1968, Brian Jones wrote, "They're not singing to an audience of mortals, but rather an incantation to those on another plane."
What sort of associations does this visit call up for you?
I suppose it. No, I just went in the Bashir's bedroom. There's a big picture of Brian there, and it sort of evokes that period a little bit. I mean, it was something that Brian talked about and so on. This particular village, I'd never been here before.
What did he tell you about the village after he first visited here?
I don't know how and what his... I don't remember him describing it in very lucid terms. He just would play the tapes over and over and over.
Now, it's really a music that's associated with madness and healing. So what was it that obsessed Brian about the music?
Yeah, a pretty psychotic time, that. Probably had a lot to do with it. The fact that it, in that period, everyone was taking lots of acid and so on. I think that was just Brian, this was a kind of part of the acid experience, I'm guessing. I don't know. But I think so. It certainly was a bit on the edge, all the experiences he was going through, I think.
How much did his interest in this music influence the music that the Stones made? Because that was also the period of Paint It Black and We Love You.
No. Well, the Paint It Black really was before all this.
But also We Love You and Satanic Majesties. Yeah.
Well, there was an interest in sort of what was now called world music at that time. And so we were all very interested in that. I don't think Brian had any kind of exclusivity on that interest. It was an interest to everybody.
Now, what sort of effect did the music have on you when you first heard it after Brian had brought those tapes back from his recording trip here?
Well, I thought it was very strange because it was done here rather than... It was done in their own village, in their own time, and so on. And I think they got pretty crazy. I mean, we went on and on and on probably for days, non-stop, more or less. I think that was the stamina of the musicians that you could see the other day. They didn't really seem to tire them out to play these very long sections with all that breath and so on, and it's quite tiring banging a drum for sort of 6 or 7 minutes, and they just went on and on. So I think the stamina thing was great, you know, these people, and they were smoking keef and they were playing this music for days and nights on end and got quite carried away. I mean, it's very hypnotic.
Thank you.
some ways, coming up here brings everything round full circle.
In a certain way, it's a sort of digression from hard rock, which is nice. And it's a nice experience for the band to have together, to do something just to get out of a studio or out of a rehearsal room and experience a different kind of music to get together. Bring it around full circle, it's like, it's a revisit, and I think that's good that there's some historical continuity rather than if we went somewhere where we didn't know and taking it completely a chance or a shot or something that was just a sort of trend that we'd kind of latched onto, where it feels there's a sort of a twinning between the two bands here a little bit, you know?
Sunday.
Yeah.
You were there for a long time?
I've been there about 9 months like this.
Really?
My first trip to the United States.
You like it? It's very different.
You know, it's very different.
Like New York is different.
Mm-hmm.
Very.
New York is very different from the rest of America.
Yes. Yeah, I know. I visit Boston too.
Ah, yeah. I just did some odds and ends, and Chuck did some bits. And...
Charlie, drop your head down a little. Lamp glancing.
Keep
you come through the hairpin? Now with your eyes. Whoops. It's the best look.
Prospect of dying in the screen.
Mick?
Yeah,
that's it.
Well, I'm not going to tell you who I'm
at
the
end of
the
night.
Who was in charge of the guard, the prison head prison guard officer?
Scrubs.
Yeah. He was head security at the models' dance. He said, "Give my love a kick." I said, "What?" He said, "Well, I was."
Is he the one that said, "You'll be back"?
Yeah. He said, "I was
decorate the Christmas tree
guard at the Scrubs when they let him out."
Stones flew off for a hugely successful American tour to coincide with the release of their new album, Steel Wheels. Back in Morocco, the musicians of Djajouka carry on a musical tradition dating back centuries.